Samos lies in the bounds of the eastern Aegean adjacent to the Asia Minor coast, covers an area of 476 square kilometers, and is home to approximately 40,000 people. It is not far from the sister cities of ancient Ionia like Ephesus, Miletus, Priene, and Smyrna in the north. There are two versions to account for the name of the island. One states that Samos is derived from the Phoenician word Sama, which means high place. The other refers to the son of Angeos, Samo, who was a settler on the island. Samos was also known as Hydriel, Hydrusa, Anthemusa, and other names, most of which denote the island's lush vegetation. The original inhabitants were the Carians, Lelegies, and Pelasgians. According to legend, Anteos, who participated in the Argonautical expedition, made use of the legendary ship's timber to set up a temple in honor of goddess Hera. The goddess's veneration is dated to that time. The temple became a great center of worship, not only for the Samians, but also for all Ionians of the area. Thank you. The gigantic statue of Kouros was just one of the many offered to the great temple, which is chronologically linked to the time of tyrant Polycrates of Samos. His reign is one of glory, and this time was certainly the most distinguished for the island. Pythagoras, Aristarchus, Aesop, Broichus, Theodorus, and Epicurus were just a few names that glorify the history of Samos in antiquity. Samos's fastest trireme, the Samina, traded throughout the Mediterranean. Herodotus describes vividly the three engineering feats: the Temple of Hera as the largest of its type in the ancient world, the ancient port of Samos with its 400-meter mole as a wonder, and the 1,036-meter-long underground tunnel that provided the town with ample fresh water as a technological marvel. The archaeological artifacts dating to Roman times are countless and significant. Luxurious mansions, temples, gymnasiums, a theater, and major complex of baths have come to light following a series of systematic excavations. Samos finds itself in the center of the vast Eastern Roman Empire as soon as Constantinople becomes its capital. Monasteries, chapels, and churches such as Vronda, Holy Trinity, Prophet Elijah, St. George of Drakei, Holy Cross, and others testify to the passage of this glorious Christian empire. Just before and after the fall of Constantinople, Samos is targeted by pirates, whose frequent attacks drive most of the inhabitants to the neighboring island of Chios. The few that remained headed for higher, inaccessible ground. A major movement of population is rumored to have occurred between 1450 to 1570. We know very little of what exactly happened during the Middle Ages on the island. What we know comes mainly from manuscript accounts in monasteries. A century later, the island is resettled by Christian Greek-speaking peoples through the initiative of an Ottoman admiral who, passing by the island, notices and is impressed by its rare natural beauties and wildlife. Dawn of the 19th century finds Samos still under Ottoman rule, following the fate of other rural Mediterranean lands. In the 1821 revolution, Samos plays a leading role alongside the charismatic figure of Lycurgus Logothetis. Samos was at the receiving end of three fierce enemy attacks, but managed to survive, retain its liberty, and provide safety to its inhabitants, who were very fortunate not to have experienced the Turkish atrocities like other Greek areas. Nonetheless, the island was not allowed to become part of the newly established Greek state until 1913. In 1834, with the Treaty of London, Samos is proclaimed a principality, a semi-autonomous island state. During this regime, Christian prince appointed by the Sultan of Constantinople, ruled Samos. However, the island enjoyed many privileges, the most important, not having any Turkish troops on its territory. Samos developed and progressed to a large degree during this time. The international financial environment favored the trading of Samian products like wine and tobacco. Samian wine was a much sought product throughout Europe, and this benefited all people involved in its production. By the end of the 19th century, the island's infrastructure is further developed. Commercial banks, insurance companies, large shops, schools, a tram network are established in the two main towns of Karlovasi and Vathi, which in comparison to other deprived Greek-speaking areas displayed a high level of urban sophistication. With the fall of the hegemonic regime in 1912, Samos is officially part of the modern Hellenic state. From 1912 and onwards, the turning points of Samian history were the arrival of refugees from the Asia Minor catastrophe, the Italo-German co-occupation in the Second World War, and the creation of a strong resistance group. Following the Italian capitulation and subsequent German invasion, thousands fled to the Middle East. The liberation of the island in 1945 did not bring the much desired peace that was delivered elsewhere. From 1946 to 1949, the island was ravaged by scuffles between mountain guerrilla fighters and government forces backed by Britain and later the US. This was the Greek Civil War. Tourism appears in the 1960s, and today is the most profitable enterprise on the island. The hospitality industry, with a capacity of 17,000 beds, alongside the presence of the university, provide employment to thousands of local people. The result is a booming local economy and steady growth. Samos has three large sea gates, a marina, and the brand new state-of-the-art air terminal that links the island domestically and internationally. The island generates its own power through an electricity plant, while the numerous wind turbines boost the network during periods of high consumer demand. The island's rich cultural heritage is combined with the present cultural events organized by various committees, councils, drama and dance groups, choirs and cinematography clubs.
Μετά την ένωση του νησιού με την Ελλάδα, στα 1912, εκδόθηκαν εκτός από το Αιγαίο και πολλές άλλες εφημερίδες διαφόρων αποχρώσεων, με μακροβιότερες την εφημερίδα των Σαμίων από το 1929 μέχρι το 1941, την Ελλάδα 1945-1977 και το Σαμιακό Βήμα που συνεχίζει να εκδίδεται μέχρι τις μέρες μας. Στη Σάμο σήμερα κυκλοφορούν και άλλες τρεις εβδομαδιαίες εφημερίδες, ο Σαμιακός Τύπος, η Σαμιακή και η Χαραυγή. Εκδίδονται και δύο αξιόλογα περιοδικά, το λογοτεχνικό περιοδικό Απόπλους και η κοινωνική και πολιτιστική επιθεώρηση Μεθόριος του Αιγαίου. Τα περιοδικά αυτά συνεχίζουν, θα λέγαμε, το έργο της Σαμιακής επιθεώρησης που εκδίδονταν ως τα μέσα της δεκαετίας του 1990 και της οποίας η προσφορά παραμένει αξεπέραστη στο χώρο των Σαμιακών γραμμάτων. Αξιόλογο εκδοτικό έργο επιτελούν στα πλαίσια των δραστηριοτήτων τους στο νησί το Πνευματικό Ίδρυμα Νικόλαος Δημητρίου και Όμιλος Κοινωνικής και Πολιτιστικής Παρέμβασης Σάμου, με βιβλία που αναδεικνύουν πλευρές της ιστορίας του νησιού, αλλά και το ταλέντο των σαμιωτών συγγραφέων. Πάμπολες είναι και οι εφημερίδες των τοπικών σαμιακών συλλόγων, καθώς και τα έντυπα των Σαμίων της Διασποράς.
The majority of the island's inhabitants are primarily engaged in agriculture and in particular viniculture and olive production, which unfortunately bear numerous problems. A farmer at work told us.
Περοκαλλιέργεια είναι το μόνο προϊόν που δίνει ψωμί στους αγρότες της Σάμου. Αλλά όμως δεν βρεθήκαν άνθρωποι να το προωθήσουν το προϊόν, να μας μείνει και εμάς κάτι που να μπορέσουμε να ζήσουμε σαν άνθρωποι. Με έχω 26 στρέμματα αμπέλια και ασχολούμαι εγώ και η γυναίκα μου, τα παιδιά μου δεν ασχολούνται καθόλου με τη γεωργία ή άλλες δουλειές. Κουραζόμαστε χωρίς να απολαμβάνουμε.
Samos Wine Co-op in Karlovasi and Samos is the official representative of all those involved with viniculture and the production and export of high-quality wine. The whole process of olive oil production is laborious work. Olive presses are state of the art. The olive core, a byproduct of the olive oil extracting process, is used in the manufacture of an environmentally friendly soap by the Kandouris company in Marth Campos. The old tanneries in Karlovasi stand like ghosts, reminiscent of a glorious past. There was a time when hundreds of tanners worked day and night to provide for their families and to build the wealth that is manifested in grand mansions, architectural splendor, and the cultural heritage visible even today in coastal Karlovasi. Only 2 to 3 tanneries survive today. Modern crystal and glass factory, 4 bottling companies, numerous floral and vegetable greenhouses, seafood processing plants, apiculture and boat building are also crucial in sustaining the local economy. Fishing still depends on traditional methods and malleable wooden boats in order to provide the best the sea has to offer to the local population. Apiculture is widespread on the island. Local honey is of the finest quality due to the abundance and variety of plants. Thousands of years, wooden boat builders have worked pine wood to create the best vessels that can be built for our seas. God created man from dirt, and man in turn created tools, utensils, and finally works of art from this dirt. Samian potters are distinct craftsmen, faithful to their tradition, and passionate perfectionists. As regards to healthcare and preventative medicine, the General Hospital of Samos, the Medical Center of Karlovasi, and many village medical centers provide good quality care to those in need. The archaeological, natural history, and folk museums and numerous monuments scattered on the island are witnesses to the evolution that the land has undergone. The island has constantly struggled to rise from the ruins of the past damages and the ashes of the 2000 Holocaust. Right beside the charcoal trunks, young trees shoot their roots deep without any human intervention, while on bare rock, newborn life flourishes against all odds. Widespread abandonment is evident everywhere. Yet the pace of progress is remarkable on the island. Next to the ruins of the past, new hope springs in the newly founded modern homes. The island, a land many times abandoned, a place of sweet homecoming, travels in time with great pride and beauty. We quote a verse of a local popular romantic poet. Had I for a flash mirrored the sea, I would embrace the beauty of the Samian land in its entirety.
Welcome to Discovering Orthodox Christianity. I'm Stacey Spanos, your host for this series of programs designed to explain the basic teachings of Orthodox Christianity. We're honored to be filming at the Holy Cross Chapel on the campus of Hellenic College, Holy Cross Greek Orthodox School of Theology in Brookline, Massachusetts. In today's program, we'll discuss the House of God, architecture, vestments, and religious articles used within the church. Our distinguished guests are Dr. Helen C. Evans. She holds the position of Mary and Michael Jaharis Curator for Byzantine Art at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. Nice to have you here. We also have here today Dr. Anton C. Vrain. He is the Director of Religious Education for the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese of America and also author of the book, The Educating Icon. Thank you for being with us today. Dr. Evans, let's begin with you. Orthodox church architecture is certainly very distinct. How so? Explain to us the many different facets of the church.
Well, Orthodox church architecture, as we think of it, is like the building we're in, a centrally focused building with a dome. Originally, Orthodox church architecture was far more varied, and you see it's the Monastery of St. Catherine at Sinai, a church built by the Emperor Justinian, which is still a basilica. But by today, we think generally of this tradition that begins really in the middle Byzantine period, where the church is brought together in a very protective, to me, very enveloping space, where you enter through the narthex, where you leave the secular world and prepare to come into the holy. In the Middle Ages, there were often tombs in that area, and then into the nave, which is where we, the lay public, gather, and then you have the icon screen, the iconostasis, the barrier, and beyond it, the apse with the altar, which is where the Eucharist is prepared and therefore in many ways the most sacred part. And above us, we are protected in a way by an image of Christ Pantocrator in the dome above the portion where we, the congregation, are. And in the apse, the image of the Virgin, who is a mediator. She is of earth and of heaven and mediates between us. There are many, many ways to read these images, and they all speak to reaching from the earthly level to the divine.
Let's go back to the narthex. This is the front doors.
The front door, vestibule, the foyer.
And what does that signify there, the narthex?
It's the transitional space. You, as Helen was saying, you're in the world. You're walking down the street, and you just don't want to jump in to this holy environment that the church building is. And so the narthex, the entryway, becomes this transitional space where you can begin to focus, begin to observe your dedication by lighting a candle, venerating an icon, greeting your neighbor, that kind of, so that you're preparing you to walk into the nave and participate in the worship service, the liturgy of that day, whatever it happens to be.
So then you enter the nave.
Right.
What is the decorum for being in the nave?
Decorum for the nave. And the interesting word is the nave means naphtis. It comes from naphtis, which means the ship. It's the ark. We're in this ark, and we're gathered around to hear the words of the prayers, to attend to the scriptural readings, to sing the hymns of praise that the congregation will sing to God, and then to participate in the Sunday liturgy, the Eucharist, in the meal, the Last Supper, where it's being recreated in some ways for us so that we can participate in Holy Communion. So at a very practical level, you should be respectful. You should be recognizing you're in a holy place. We think of the sanctuary behind the icon screen as the holy place, but it's the Holy of Holies. This is the holy place. And so we really should be respectful, proper decorum and behavior. You know, it's not a place to go running around and things like that.
And the altar is, of course, where the mystery of Christ kind of all comes together for Orthodox Christians. Tell me about some of the things in the altar, Dr. Evans.
The objects that are on the altar, and we have some of them here, are the objects that are used to prepare and then to serve the Eucharist, which is an evocation of the Last Supper and the gathering together of the disciples with Christ. And we, in a way, become part of that brotherhood of disciples by the activity of participating in this event. We don't actually know what the first Christians in 50 AD used for the Eucharist, but they have to have had a container that held liquid, and they have to have had something that held bread, because he said to take the bread and the wine in memory of him. We have these works that show in a way the fact that all the traditions remain the same, they also evolve. And the two silver pieces, probably pewter, are copies of a paten, the flat dish for the bread, and the chalice for the wine from the 6th century.
This is a replica of something that was used in the 6th century, so very simple.
So 500s, very simple, but the original would have been a yard wide.
The plate
would have been silver. It's the original. There are examples at Dumbarton Oaks in Washington. They are huge. They speak of an immense number of people coming together to participate. And if you look at the chalice, this one is maybe half or a third of the size of the original. So you have a huge, very welcoming bowl for the wine and a small knob, so that you would be holding it separately.
And back in the olden days, did they sip from the cup? Now the priest feeds us through a spoon, for lack of a better phrase.
The practice of using the spoon came about, as I'm told, in the 9th, 10th century. Prior to that, yes, people would have partaken straight from the cup itself. Or the cup would have, a large cup could be used for a large congregation, then parceled out into smaller cups for people to drink from. But this became a much more efficient way of doing it, and also allowing, there was a concern for the proper respect, that you don't come here and gulp from this chalice.
Right.
You just take a sip. That's, you know, so this idea that you can kind of imagine somebody say, well, if I just drink more, I'll be more holy or better communion.
Or I'm sick, maybe I'll get a little bit better.
And so the church wants to say, no. Just a small spoonful is enough.
So talk to me about the difference in the styles here.
Well, it goes back to all the things that have happened. Christianity has existed now for more than 2,000 years, and what was the style of one century is replaced by the style of the other. The use remains the same. What I find fascinating about the evolution is that it becomes more theatrical, that the chalice is now here, and you have a large space, so you have something that you can present quite dramatically, and the paten has also been put on a stand. So the ability of the congregation, perhaps, to see in to the altar and to see what is happening is clear are these would have been used before the icons block the view of the altar. It may have been a different sense of what is a type of performance that we are invited from this section to participate in without actually, particularly for women, entering this, the holiest of holy ourselves.
That's right, because women do not have access
to the sanctuary.
To the sanctuary.
With just a couple of here exceptions with the proper blessing to do a task. Technically, no person who doesn't have a task, male or female, is allowed in the sanctuary. But in a convent, a nun may enter the sanctuary or something like that.
Tell me about something that, embarrassingly enough, I just learned about shortly after, well, September 11th, 2001. In many churches, and correct me if I'm wrong, is it all churches, there is something called a relic in the sanctuary. Well, what is that?
Well, a relic is a piece, usually a bone fragment, because they can last a long time, of the saint, of a saint. But it could be a relic of other items as well. But we'll leave it with the saints, a part of their body, a part of a bone, a fragment. And this becomes another connection between the believer, the faithful, and this individual. You're in, by being in the presence of the relic, you're being in the presence of the person whose relic it is. And in the church, going back to the very early on, second century, Christians would gather around the relics of their saints to celebrate the Eucharist, to pray, to sing praises to God, honor the life of this usually frequently martyr, and participate in the life of the church in this way. And so today, the relics could be placed in the table, in the altar table, as part of the consecration of a church, so that to remind us of this gathering around the body, the relic of the saint, but they could also be placed in small reliquaries, just as fancy or as simple as these objects in front of us, for direct veneration, processions, etc.
And I should explain, I learned about it on September, shortly after September 11th, because of the Greek Orthodox Church that was destroyed, that was at the base of the towers on that tragic day.
Yes, and so you can think of some object from that church as becoming a relic of that, and so to be in the presence of that item, that object, is to be in the to remind us everything to do with that day in that church. That's why we go to place, even with September 11th, that's why we still gather at places that have part of the iron structure of the building.
Sure.
That too is a relic of that event.
There are different styles in churches when it comes to Greek Orthodox and Russian Orthodox. With Russian Orthodoxy, we tend to think of those beautiful golden domes in the churches. What are the differences?
Well, Russian churches originally, the first generation of them, are built by men going from Constantinople. They are converted from the imperial center, and there's a wonderful primary text about Russian visitors being sent to Constantinople and writing back that when they were in Hagia Sophia, they didn't know if they were in heaven or on earth, and that that was the religion they should convert to. So the first generation is really not very different. Probably there were many more golden domes in the Byzantine world than we think of now, and certainly in Novgorod. The Hagia Sophia in Novgorod is an evocation of Constantinople. Over time, the Russian churches, many of which were built in wood, get these fantastically shaped domes. The onion domes and other shapes, and St. Basil's in Moscow, right outside of the Kremlin, and Red Square has all sorts of domes, and they're gilded. So we think of them as being very different. But if you went inside and followed the paths that are needed for the performance of the religious rites, they're not that different.
Right. It, again, I think it reflects the an aesthetic that the Russian tradition has. They, from what I've been told, they like things that are tall and very dramatic, and it reflected in the and it reflects in their architecture. It needs to stand out in some way, and the modern the Greek aesthetic was a little bit different, and remained stayed the same. just as our American aesthetic about architecture is very different.
And I'm thinking about my home church in Florida. It does not look like a traditional church like this one does. And apparently that's okay.
That's okay. It could,
inside it certainly does.
Inside, I'm sure it looked very similar to this. But it could be everything from the tradition of how the community built it or bought it from someone else, how they tried to make it work for what they had available to them, and both the financial resources, the size of the community, things like that. And then, or did they go and build it? And again, we see here in the United States, architects looking at the standard tradition of a dome and apse, this layout, and then saying, well, we can use different materials. We can fuse it with a different eyepiece because this is America. We do things a little different.
Our aesthetic.
We have our own aesthetic. And so, especially from the 50s through the, even to, down to today, but certainly 1950s, 60s, 70s, you see this very, kind of a, what some people call neo-Byzantine, this kind of mixture of traditional with something very, very modern. Sometimes it worked well, sometimes it didn't.
Frank Lloyd Wright did.
Frank Lloyd Wright.
A Greek Orthodox church.
Is that right?
No. Yeah.
It's where, quite lovely.
Where is that?
Annunciation Church in Milwaukee.
Milwaukee.
It was one of his last commissions. It was built in the late 50s. And he designed it, but as in
and it looks like a quintessential Frank Lloyd Wright.
You know it's Frank Lloyd Wright.
Structure. Okay.
Yeah, you know it's Frank Lloyd Wright. But he, as Frank Lloyd Wright did, he designed everything from the building to the pews to the icon screen. Everything that was.
So this obviously there are certain rules that the architect has to follow, at least in terms of the interior, not necessarily the exterior.
Well, I think the biggest rule is to separate the congregation from the holiest of holies. The way Frank Lloyd Wright did his icon screen is not like any other one I've ever seen in any church.
Definitely not. No, an architect today will work with a community that needs to build something. They'll work with, we need a narthex, a nave, a sanctuary. We need space for people to move around.
Do those plans get approved at some point by a metropolitan?
Yes. The congregation will send their plans to the local bishop for approval for both the architect, the design, on the understanding that he probably has a little more experience doing this than a typical congregation will, and then also approve who designs the icon screen, who paints the icons, all of those kinds of things, just so that things are done well and properly. And again, thinking of things that a congregation wouldn't think of, like, you know, how do you get people from one end of the building to the other and comfort and safety?
Does the altar have to face any particular direction?
The tradition is they face east, face the rising sun.
Is that always done?
Not always. Sometimes the real estate doesn't quite do what you want it to do.
Doesn't quite fit, right.
Yeah, but more often than not, that's what they try to make it happen.
How does the architecture of the church reflect the artwork inside?
Well, usually it's built enough at the same time the artwork is added that they are of the same period. But sometimes you have very, very modern buildings in which you have brought very old images. It doesn't, even here in this church, which is a 20th century, mid-20th century church, there are elements that were built that were contemporary with it but evoke different periods in Byzantine art. So I don't think you can ever think of it as one has to be like the other. It's what you want it to be is harmonious. And I think perhaps to go back to your question about Greek versus Russian, Greek architecture, like Greek traditions, often stresses the harmonious, the symmetrical, the balanced, the calm, as opposed to the dramatically exaggerated or unbalanced, and that it gives you, as in this building, a sense of peace to be in the space.
Let's talk about some of the vestments that the priests and the deacons wear. And I know you have
an icon
here. If you could hold that up
and
give people an example of what we're talking about.
What I'm holding up is an icon of St. Ambrose. And we know Ambrose of Milan, the 4th century bishop of the church. And he's wearing a bishop's vestments. But what's interesting,
and how do we know it's a bishop's
it's a bishop's vestment is because he's wearing the traditional great omophorion of the bishop. We think of the bishop wearing this very large wrap over everything else, which crosses on it. And it carries down over here and down in front of him. And it's the quintessential vestment of a bishop. It's kind of what signifies this is a bishop of the church, as opposed to the more simple stole, the epitrachilion of the priest, which is the piece that runs, it goes down his neck and in front of him, or the orarion, the kind of this belt-like item that the deacon wears and holds up when he's singing the petitions. So each rank of clergy has these distinctive elements to it, and to them rather. And yet, even in this icon, we know there's a bit of an anachronism here.
Why?
Well, bishops didn't always wear this. This is a later tradition. And so, as the church became more developed, and in the first 6 centuries, you couldn't tell a priest from a bishop from a deacon. They all kind of look the same. But as things become more structured, and rigorous around that, then the rank became important. And so the clothing item begins to reflect the rank. Just think of it in kind of military terms. Oh, that's a bad analogy in some ways. You can tell the generals from the privates.
Sure.
So,
Dr. Evans, from an artist's perspective, when you look at the vestments, what do you think? Because some of them are, especially during services, especially during Holy Week, are quite beautiful.
Oh, they're exquisite. And some of the most beautiful are not just the patterns, because I find in this tradition where you use a play of crosses against voids and you can read them in many ways to be exceptional, you have the ones that at the greatest are walking icons. They are the narrative scenes of the life of Christ or images of Christ and the Virgin, where if you think of the stationary icons, the icons that are the architecture of the Pantocrator and the dome, the Virgin and the apse, and then add the priest coming and going, wearing them, they're kind of the most movable of icons and bring the whole meaning of the church to life, and we're meant to do that.
Right.
It was always meant to have a deep meaning. What we think is that in the first generations, just as we don't know what you first used to hold the wine, we don't know what the men who were serving it wore, but that they're wearing the dress in some way that was what you wore in the second, third century, which was a large tunic, and that then evolves into the basic level of the priestly garments. And the more elaborate ones, as he was saying, get added as you are increasingly identifying rank, and to a degree, certainly in the later centuries, taking on the role of the secular authority that is eroding.
And we did not discuss this in the icon segment, but I'd like to bring it up now because I see this icon,
yeah,
the priests who do this with their fingers.
The gesture,
what does that mean?
Well, it's a gesture of blessing. You can see it in the icon of Christ, John the Baptist, and it's the gesture of blessing. The traditional blessing was we'd be done with two fingers and then to make the sign of the cross. And then over time, the Byzantines get, and especially in icons, it stylizes it into this rather elaborate gesture, and it becomes a Christogram. The tradition today would tell us that we're forming the letters ICXC in our fingers, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christos. And so even the message is, it's not the priest who's blessing you or the bishop, it's Christ. But it starts out as a very much more simple gesture with two fingers. We see it today, sometimes just the hand, as a gesture of blessing.
Let's talk about the significance of the censer that is used in the service. Explain to us what that is.
Well, the censer is a wonderful container for incense, which when lit perfumes the space, and the deacon swings it. And it is so much a role that the deacon does that Stephen, the proto-martyr, the first saint, is shown as a deacon, and he's often shown from the very earliest times swinging a censer. So in a way, his
Even
symbol.
Even if he probably didn't do that in reality.
But from a fairly early date, we associate it with him. And censers were used everywhere. They were used in pagan temples. They were used in your private homes.
And why were they used?
probably to make the air smell better. And because it's a luxurious gift, it's among the gifts to the Christ child, gold, incense,
very
and myrrh.
True, right.
So from the beginning, the idea that you would have this association, but
And your question points to a lot of these things that we instantly go jump into the kind of mystical, spiritual, religious realm had very, very practical purposes. Perfume the air. The Jews practiced animal sacrifice. But around that sacrificial table, they're burning a lot of incense. Because as you can imagine, sacrificing animals isn't pleasant to the senses. And so you're trying to offset some of that. Now, people back then would have been accustomed to animal flesh and all these kinds of things. But again, it's trying to do this in a way that was pleasing to God, cover up what needed to be covered up. And then we begin then to ascribe other kinds of significance to it as we begin to reflect on it. And certainly by today, when we're not doing any of those kinds of things.
Beautiful symbol that is used in the divine liturgy is the Bible. And we've got an example over your shoulder there. Talk to me about the significance of what is on that Bible. Okay, are they all the same in each Orthodox church?
It's the book of the Gospels. It's the book of the daily New Testament Gospel lectionaries, the four evangelists. Not the full Bible, not even the full New Testament. Basically, the daily reading of one of the four evangelists that's done every day within the liturgical cycle of the church. And most of them they're printed in such a way so that here's the section you read today, here's the section you read tomorrow, and then other kind of events and services and things like that. And then this book is bound and then becomes decorative over time. Again, they probably weren't always this elaborate, and certainly not as elaborate as the one we have here, to remind us of this is an important text, part of the theater. Your eye's going to be grabbed to this. I need to pay attention to this. And also our respect. This is the Word of God. The Word of God is a treasure. We're going to cover the Word of God in our best finery.
And is it standard what symbolism is on the book here, the Gospels here?
Well, not altogether. To go back to our icon, which in the depiction of the Gospel that he is holding, it's decorated with rich jewels. So the decoration with rich jewels and gold is, I think, something that one aspires to through the centuries, because this is a pattern that's very similar to the one that you see on the 6th century icon of Christ at Sinai holding a gospel. What is usually added are images of the four evangelists, because it's their words that through which God, Christ is speaking on them. You can have crosses. You can have, as on this one, beautiful flowers, auspicious symbols that are not necessarily in the beginning totally concrete in a religious image. And you are more than anything else showing that you respect the quality of what the word is and recognize its significance. And as you remember in the service, the book is brought in and is processed. So to have something that responds to light and sparkles is important.
What does the Orthodox Church say, Dr. Vrahm, about the trend now towards things a little bit more ornate, a little bit more embellished? Because a lot of people say Christianity is about keeping it simple.
Keeping it simple. Well, I think the two examples here show that over time, our understanding of who we are as Christians and as church also reflects these things. And so we would say this embellished, quite elaborate paten and chalice is reminding us of the heavenly kingdom. When you're with the king, you want to bring out the things that are the most elaborate, the most beautiful that you can have, and we would associate that with these two items here. But yet, we're in a moment perhaps now too where some people are saying, that king was a simple king, Jesus. He never wore a crown, he never wore fancy robes or anything like that. And so the style would reflect this, the one that's in, right in front of me, much more simple. And so we're constantly navigating through that.
You all often hear the term house of God. Do we have a responsibility to keep faithful to that term? Is this a house of God?
I think all Christians have a responsibility to, and wherever they are worshiping, respect that term.
Yeah, we say this is the place where God dwells, where we interact with God most directly. Yeah, I can step outside in the courtyard here and interact with God in prayer and things like that. But it's here where it's more concentrated in some way, more focused, and trying to draw me in more intentionally than when I'm walking down the hill and admiring the trees and the flowers. And I can look at those trees and flowers and say, what a wonderful God we have who gave us these things. But yeah, it's the house of God.
And it's consecrated. I mean, to agree, that's what you're saying. This is a space that was built and people of faith came together and said, this is a place we will worship.
Right, which goes to the term holy, that this is a holy space, this whole building. And holy at its core understanding was set apart. And so this place was set apart for one task and one thing only, and that was to glorify God. It wasn't meant to, become a kitchen. It wasn't meant to be something else. It wasn't meant even to be a TV studio.
Which some people have
criticized.
Which
some people have wondered about.
Right.
Why are we doing this here? But we're doing... But
why are we doing it here?
Well, because this is a teaching... The church is also a teaching space. We have a pulpit where the congregation is instructed. We have a place where we can gather around and we can hear a sermon and we hear the Word of God read to us so we can learn it. And so this space is becoming just a new place with a new medium of expression and to communicate the same gospel truth that I can read to you or preach to you from a pulpit.
Well, Dr. Vrame and Dr. Evans, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
And to see more programs in the series Discovering Orthodox Christianity, please visit youtube.com/Greek Orthodox Church. I'm Stacey Spanos. Thanks for joining us.